And now it's my pleasure to introduce a great friend. And I'd like to tell my friend John McDonough what we're trying to accomplish here. We basically, the Partnership for Quality Care is a nationwide organization that of healthcare providers, particularly health systems throughout the United States and SEIU. We represent in our institutions work close to 2 million folks, and we basically provide healthcare coverage to more than 50 million Americans. Since we've been here, John, we yesterday had a financial analysis about the healthcare situation in this country. We had Liz Fowler, we had the members of the staff of many of the senators and congressmen who are participating in the super committee and discussing what were their perspective about it. And we started this morning by basically analyzing the wellness. We start from the premise that we as healthcare workers, we need to live a healthy lives and have a healthy healing place that so we could have our patients benefit from it. And we're going to be discussing this afternoon where do we take that. We had a conversation with Dr. Brand from the HRSA about the future workforce of our country and the workforce that is going to be needed to cover those and give care to those 32 million additional Americans. You heard a part of a panel that basically is trying to identify areas that we could, let me back up. We basically thought that we needed to go to the, once the Affordable Care Act was enacted, that we needed to go to the second phase, which was how do we improve the quality of the care and how do we have better outcomes. We identify the areas that we believe that were one of the most important areas, like, for example, sepsis, hospital-acquired infections, dealing with the explosion of asthma in our country, diabetes and obesity, and what's the workforce of the future that we need. And that's are the areas that we're working on, and we're reporting on the progress that we've been doing in all of those areas. And now we come to you, where we want you to explain to all of us what are the implications of the Affordable Care Act, and particularly the quality of areas of it. For now, if you allow me to introduce you to the group, I think it was Celia and Megan from Massachusetts who basically, when Andy Stern asked me about two years ago, whatever, to be the point person for SEIU and healthcare reform, they said, you gotta meet this guy by the name of John McDonough. And I said, well, okay. So then later on, I found out that John not only is a PhD in public health and all of that stuff, but he was a legislator and a member of the assembly for 13 years in Massachusetts. But more important than that, he was the executive director of Massachusetts Healthcare for All. He was there at the table when healthcare reform was enacted in Massachusetts, which basically led to a whole conversation in this country. And at the time that I met him, another dear good friend of us, Senator Ted Kennedy, basically had recruited him to come to Washington to help him, that is Senator Kennedy, help pass this whole thing, the Affordable Care Act. Once he was in Washington, I remember one day John telling me, Dennis, I think that now is hunky-dory, this whole thing. We CIU participated or created more coalitions that we could even think about. We could meet one person, okay, let's create a coalition. So, and at that moment, John says, that's all well and done, that you had all these coalitions, but this issue where there's consensus on this healthcare reform is gonna break down. And we need a group of people that at the end of the day are gonna be there in the middle of the winter when you have no boots and we gotta go to a fight. And he came up with the name of the group Winter Soldiers. And so then we created a group called the Winter Soldiers, which was the AARP, Families USA, Consumer Reports, and SEIU. Am I missing anybody?
Yeah.
and Catholic Health Association. And then basically we met on a regular basis every week to discuss what could we do to push healthcare reform forward. And then we, some of us had some strength. SEIU was strong in California, was strong in New York, strong in the Midwest. But we were very weak in some other areas. So then AARP would say, well, we will do that. We will take the areas where you guys are weak. So in essence, John had the wisdom to basically pull us together to help push this whole thing of healthcare reform. As a matter of fact, one of the wonderful things that that group did was and led that work that Kay Anderson led, where we got 75,000 stories of people who got impacted by not having healthcare coverage or lost healthcare coverage. And we basically, on a weekly basis, we could give the senators and the assembly and the congressmen that reports about the impact on, and we did it by breaking it down by their own congressional districts. So in that sense, at the end, we started to a great source of joy when we were seeing congressmen speaking about the stories that we were providing them. And in that sense, this would have never happened if it was not because of John. So, and more important than all of that is that now we have this Obamacare, we gotta repeal it, we cannot even, it's the mother of the evils, according to the opposition. And on the other hand, let me, a second here, John has written a book called Inside the National Healthcare Reform. And I had the opportunity last week hearing him speak about, and I was there, I was front seat, I was participating, and I could not even understand well the Affordable Care Act until I heard John. And now I'm in the process of reading his book. The first part of the book is easy reading, but the second one is pretty dense because it's the one that basically takes you from to Title I, Title II, Title III, Title IV, and you gotta read it like three or four times to basically get it. So. I it's with great joy and pleasure that I bring somebody that we need at this moment to help us explain to the American public the Affordable Care Act, John McDonough.
Morning, everybody. Okay, all right. Nice to be here with you. Somebody ought to do an oil painting of the Winter Soldiers and put them in the proper context of Valley Forge, because that was the image that I was thinking of when I suggested that we needed something like that, and definitely you would have Dennis right there in the center of it with the ragged clothes and all the rest, but it really was SEIU and that set of key partners who were there throughout this process, through thick and thin, no matter what, helping to make it happen with a lot of the other allies in the room. And I hope particularly all the folks from SEIU take enormous pride in this. There's just no doubt about it that there wouldn't have been an Affordable Care Act had it not been for the extraordinary contributions of SEIU. And so, my applause to you. And I wrote this book because I do have this sense that I imagine a lot of you share that, you know, everybody has an opinion about the Affordable Care Act in the United States. People like it, people hate it. There are very few undecideds in the middle. Well, there are some, but they get swayed back and forth. And yet I find that the truth is that very few people really have a good understanding of what the law actually is, what's in it. People have heard about individual mandate. People have heard about 26-year-olds staying on their parents' policy. Some people have heard about calorie labeling in restaurants. People have heard a little bit, but people lack a sense of kind of what is this as a whole. And so I wrote this book, I hope, in some way to contribute to creating some significant public understanding about it. And that is particularly even more important now. It took me a while to get it out. It just came out a month ago because I was using a university press and They told me this was chain lightning speed for them. I finished it about a year ago. So it takes a while to get through the process. And so I was concerned, it's going to come out in the summer, the fall of 2011, and who's even going to be paying attention to the Affordable Care Act at this point? And it turns out we're going to be paying attention to it an awful lot over the next 14 months. Because I think what's clear right now in terms of where the law is going is a lot of people think, well, this is going to be decided by the U.S. Supreme Court. And that's actually really not true. The Supreme Court's going to decide one piece, one section of one title on the individual mandate, and they are not going to rule on the whole law itself. What is going to matter is November 6, 2012. If we, and it's pretty plain, if Republicans hold on to the House, take the Senate, take the White House, which is certainly possible, they will, I am very confident, early in 2013, through a budget reconciliation bill, repeal most of what's in the Affordable Care Act. If Democrats take over, take the House back, hold on to the Senate and the White House, they will repeal it as close to its original design as possible. And so really, we're almost looking at the November 6, 2012 election as something that I can't even think of in historical parallel. It's a national plebiscite on the Affordable Care Act, on national health reform. People will be going to vote for a lot of other things, won't even be thinking about health care. People will vote on the economy. People will vote on foreign war issues. People will vote on all kinds of things. And yet there's no policy issue where the impact will be more clear and determinative than on the Affordable Care Act. So part of my mission and my goal in terms of trying to be helpful to advancing health improvement and health justice across the United States is to do as much as I can to try to explain the law. And so what I want to try to do today, just very briefly, is give you a sense of the overall architecture of the law and understand how it fits together and how it works, and then particularly focus on the parts of the law that deal with improving the quality of care and understanding what those are and where they're in there, and then have a couple of surprises for you at the end in terms of things that you ought to know and understand moving forward, because there's something different happening right now that very, very few people seem to be aware of that is momentously important and very unfamiliar. But stay on the edge of your seat and I'll get to that, okay? So let's start. So just like a book has chapters, and believe me, I know a book has chapters, and a play has acts and scenes, and a baseball game has innings, a federal law, a federal statute has titles. And the ACA has titles. It has 10 of them. And people think, well, the law is big and it's complicated and it's a mess. And what I try to say is, well, we have a healthcare system that's big and complicated and a mess. And so a law that tries to do comprehensive reform to the whole system is also going to appear big and complicated and a mess. But if you actually just take a moment to look at it, and this is just table of contents stuff, folks. This isn't rocket science here. And you look at it, you can actually see in the architecture of the law a clear rationale, sense of purpose line in terms of how it does it. So let me just talk very briefly about it. So Title I is all things about private health insurance in the United States. It is literally, if it is implemented as written, a revolution in terms of how health insurance business is done in the United States, private health insurance. Medical underwriting, pre-existing condition exclusions will be history beginning in 2014, and guaranteed issue for all Americans will be the norm. And accompanying that, so that that is a stable new system, is an individual responsibility requirement, otherwise known as the individual mandate. I kind of take issue with the term individual mandate, even though that's how people understand it. Let me tell you an individual mandate. Switzerland has an individual mandate, okay? In Switzerland, it is national law that you have to buy health insurance. By the way, it's all private insurance. There's no public coverage at all. But so it's national law. You, as a Swiss citizen, must buy health insurance. And if you don't, then the government buys it for you and sends you a bill and make sure you pay. Now that's a mandate, okay? What we have in Massachusetts is we have a financial penalty on those who can afford to buy health insurance and choose not to do so, okay? So we have every year in Massachusetts somewhere between 30 and 40,000 people since we started our mandate in 2007 who say, I don't want to buy health insurance, I'm going to pay the penalty. It's now maximum of about $1,200 in Massachusetts, and that's their right. They're not violating the law, they're not going to jail, they're paying the financial penalty for not having health insurance, and life goes on. And we hope they change their mind at some point and buy it in the future. And that is the structure reflected in the ACA. And then tied to the individual requirement and the insurance reform guaranteed issue are subsidies to make the purchase of health insurance affordable for all Americans. And as a lot of you know, there's a lot more in Title I, but I'm just going to give you the big headlines. Title II is a revolution in our national Medicaid program. So the saying about Medicaid is, if you've seen one state Medicaid program, you've seen one state Medicaid program, because they differ state by state so radically. Beginning in 2014, we really moved for the first time toward national uniformity and a national structure. So if your income is below 138% of the federal poverty line, no matter what state you're in, Massachusetts, Texas, Arkansas, Washington, wherever, you are eligible to enroll in your state Medicaid program. That is enormously consequential. Most Americans think Medicaid covers all poor people. It never has. It will begin to, beginning in 2014. Title III is the one that is most pertinent to what we're talking about here today. This is the set of provisions attempting systematic improvement of quality and delivery system reform in the United States, as well as significant changes to Medicare, some to make the program better for Medicare enrollees, and some to achieve necessary savings to help pay for the cost of the law. And I'll get back to that in a minute. Title IV is all things about prevention and wellness, a national prevention strategy. And by the way, if you had the chance to take a peek at the first report, the first national prevention strategy, which was released by the Surgeon General this past June, you can get it online. I highly recommend you take a look at it. There's an idea that's been growing over the past several years in government calling for what's referred to sometimes as a health in all policies approach. So when we consider health, we have to consider transportation. We have to consider education. We have to consider all different elements and how they fit together to create healthy people. And that is embedded and enshrined in Title IV. And there are community transformation grants. There's money put on the table in a significant way to help move us toward having a more preventive outlook in our healthcare system. There's also my particular favorite, the requirement that chain restaurants beginning next year have to post the calories of all of their items on their menu boards, on their menus, on their drive-through boards. I don't know how many of you have been to New York. In the last couple of years, you walk into a Starbucks in New York, and you know that glass case in there with all the baked goods, you think, oh, how fat could that nice looking scone with the maple topping be? But in New York, you see it's like 550 calories and you do your death and you go, oh my God, no, keep away. It changed. So I gave about 15 or 20 talks in New York when I was at Hunter College last year, and I would always ask New York audience, I said, how many of you walked into a restaurant and done something differently than you otherwise would have done because you saw those numbers out there? And generally speaking, about 80% would raise their hands and say yes, and I'm one of them because I did it myself. Now, there's some dispute about how effective it is, but it makes a difference, and again, it's part of moving us forward. Title V is all things about the healthcare workforce. One of the most important parts of that law is creating a national workforce commission that will have the authority to do serious analysis and study of the healthcare workforce to prepare our health system for 32 million newly insured people coming into coverage. The Comptroller General of the General Accounting Office, as was his duty, appointed a terrific panel of people a year ago. The panel has yet been able to meet because the Republicans in the House of Representatives refused to allow the money to enable it to start its work. Everybody agrees we have serious challenges in the healthcare workforce. This is one big disappointment, but also in Title V, significant increase in money for community health centers, doubling of funding for the National Health Service Corps, lots of other things. Title VI, kind of a grab bag. A lot of provisions dealing with fraud and abuse in the Medicare program. I'm going to get back and talk about that. A much smarter approach to fraud and abuse than we've ever seen enshrined in a federal law, really providing some effective ways to keep fraudsters from getting into the program in the first place. You know, people noted back in the 1980s and 1990s that there were significant elements of organized crime in the United States that had given up on prostitution, gambling, and drugs, and getting into Medicare because the money was so much easier to steal in Medicare. So it's been a big problem. No one knows how much. Everybody agrees there's a lot. And we probably have right now the most robust effort going on fraud and abuse we've ever seen on the part of the federal government. We have transparency requirements so that beginning next year, every pharmaceutical company, medical device maker, drug company is going to have to report every financial gift or other benefit that they provide to physicians valued at more than $10. It's going to be available for public viewing on a national website. That'll be starting, I think, sometime next year. Also, something that's particularly important that I'm very interested in, something known as the Elder Justice Act, a bipartisan effort to try to elevate our response as a nation to the national tragedy of financial exploitation, neglect, and violence against senior citizens, to elevate it in the same way that we pay attention to child abuse and domestic partner abuse. Elder abuse is just as significant and just as important, and embedded in Title VI is a whole series of efforts to deal with that, along with a lot more. Title VII will directs the Food and Drug Administration for the first time to create a pathway for the approval of what are known as biosimilars, generic-like equivalents of biopharmaceutical drugs. Biopharmaceuticals is the growth in terms of prescription drugs in the United States. The European Union has allowed this pathway for more than a decade, and the Affordable Care Act finally will put the United States on a par with the European Union and other nations like Japan and Australia in being able to market and approve those kinds of much lower cost biopharmaceuticals. The cost, as you probably know, of biopharmaceuticals is sky high. And so this is one way to address those costs. CLASS was Senator Kennedy, my former boss's personal top priority in terms of the law. It is, if it is launched, and there are a lot of significant and real questions about whether or not it can be made financially viable, but if it is launched, it is a revolution in terms of national disability policy. It's a voluntary, premium-based disability program that provide cash payments for people who are disabled, either temporarily or permanently, to enable them to live independently in the community without having to do what people have to do now, which is to spend down to poverty to qualify for Medicaid. Title IX are the revenue measures to pay for a little less than half the law. And Title X is the manager's amendment, and that could take a long time to describe, so you're going to have to buy my book if you want to know what's in Title X. Okay. Just a little bit, try to understand a little bit about the people flow and the money flows in this law so you can see how it fits together, okay, how it fits together. So here's the Titles 1 through 9 on the left. And then the second column, the covered lives, that's in millions. And this is the Congressional Budget Office estimate. So CBO estimates that in by 2019, 16 million currently uninsured Americans will get covered through the private expansions and subsidies in Title I. They estimate there will be about 24 million people overall in the exchange. Not all of them will be getting subsidies. Not all of them will be currently uninsured. Some people will go from the existing non-group market into it, and so they will not be uninsured. But 16 million currently uninsured, and 16 million currently uninsured getting into Medicaid for 32 million Americans. This is a CBO estimate. And they also estimate that if we didn't do anything, that by 2019 we would have 54 million Americans without health insurance. So again, 54 minus 32 leaves about 22 million Americans. About, the Urban Institute estimates about 40% of those folks who will still be uninsured will be eligible to enroll in their state Medicaid programs, but simply not have signed up. We would obviously like them to sign up and get the preventive care benefits and other things, though beginning in 2014, if they show up at a clinic or a hospital in need of medical services, they can get enrolled in Medicaid on the spot. There will be a significant number, about a quarter of the remaining uninsured will be undocumented, and the rest will be people, for the most part, who voluntarily choose to pay the fine rather than getting coverage, and a smaller number of people who still will not have an affordable option available to them, okay? So if you look down at the next column down, the money spent, and these are gross numbers, not net, you can see where the money is being spent in the Affordable Care Act. So it's overwhelmingly being spent in Title I, the private coverage expansions, and Title II, the Medicaid expansions. Title III has some, that's mostly the cost of shrinking the so-called Medicare Part D prescription drug donut hole, the coverage gap for seniors and disabled enrollees in Medicare. But so most of the money is going there. Now, unlike 2003, when Congress passed what's known as the Medicare Modernization Act, which created the Part D program, Congress, in creating the Affordable Care Act, and the President decided we have to finance this entire law. We have to pay for it, which means we either have to raise taxes or we have to find savings in existing federal programs that will be scored as actually saving money. And so if you look at the last column by title, you can see where the money is being saved or raised. Roughly about 45% of that money is being saved through changes and reductions and reforms and other kinds of things to the Medicare program, okay? And then roughly another 45% are from the revenues in Title IX, and then everything else is pretty much cats and dogs, okay? So let's just talk about those two big ones first. So the first one is the changes in Title III to Medicare, $450 billion in savings to Medicare, okay? By the way, here's just a little editorial comment. So many people across the country know that in the Affordable Care Act, in Obamacare, that Congress and the President decided to reduce or cut, whatever they want to say, Medicare by $450 billion over 10 years, okay? It's really reducing the rate of growth in the program over 10 years. It's not cutting it below what it is now, okay? The program still grows, okay? So as probably all of you know, throughout the reform process on Capitol Hill, and particularly throughout the legislative process in the congressional election process in 2010, congressional Republicans beat Democrats over the head relentlessly saying, you cut Medicare by over $500 million to fund Obamacare. Okay? What's particularly interesting about that is you've all heard now of a gentleman from Wisconsin by the name of Paul Ryan, Congressman Ryan, head of the House Budget Committee, who came up with his own plans for a really radical change in how the Medicare program is done. And they put that forward on the House as a budget resolution, and all but three House Republicans voted for it, and they brought it up in the Senate, and all but two or three Republican senators voted for it. Embedded in Ryan's plan was the complete repeal of the Affordable Care Act, with one exception, the $450 billion in Medicare cuts and savings in Title III. Okay? Now, people didn't pay so much attention as they're paying attention to the other stuff he was proposing in terms of how elderly enrollees would be treated, but basically the entire Republican caucus, except for about five of them, endorsed that entire set of cuts that they used politically to beat Democrats over the head, and more than anything probably used that to win control of the House of Representatives last November, okay? So ironies abound. There's one other important irony here as well. I mentioned the 2003 Medicare Modernization Act, okay? So really significant difference between the 2003 law, I remember it was President Bush, Republican-controlled Senate, Republican-controlled House, created the Medicare Part D program and spent a lot of money to do it and did not raise a penny to pay for it. So the entire cost of Part D is put on to the federal deficit. And the estimate is that in the 10-year time window that the ACA was estimated, the Part D program, the Medicare prescription drug program, will add to the federal deficit over 10 years by about $1 trillion onto the deficit, okay? The Affordable Care Act, by contrast, will, according to the CBO, over that same 10-year window, reduce the federal deficit by about $70 billion, okay? So consider that contrast as you look at this. George Washington, I heard a quote from George Washington talking in the 1790s when he was president. He said, listen, when you have to have revenues, whenever you raise revenues, whoever gets raised is going to scream bloody murder, okay? And so we have people screaming bloody murder about all these things. That $450 billion in Medicare cuts, about $200 billion of it, is coming from changes to the Medicare Part C program, or Medicare Advantage, okay? And people scream that you do those changes and you're going to see enrollment in Medicare Advantage plummet and you're going to see premiums skyrocket. Just this past week, we saw new estimates for Medicare Advantage next year. Guess what? Premiums on average across the country going down 7% and enrollment is going up, okay? So $200 billion of that, and then $155 billion is coming from reductions in payments to the hospital industry over the next 10 years. I don't know how many of you participated in the marches that protested those hospital reductions. Chances are none of you did because there weren't any, because the hospital industry sat down with the Senate Finance Committee and the Obama administration and worked out an agreement, because the hospital industry wants to get the percentage of Americans with health insurance up from its current 82 to 83% up to about 95%. And if they do that, they estimate they will see new revenues of more than $200 billion. And so it's going to be a net gain for the hospital industry. There are concerns about how it's done and so forth, and those continue going forward. But so the structure of most of what was done with the agreement of the healthcare industry. On the revenue side below, the big change is a $200 billion in new revenue from Medicare taxes on high-income wage earners. So families making more than $250,000, individuals making more than $200,000 a year. And for the first time ever, Medicare/Social Security taxes on unearned income as well as earned income. So significant. And then also in Title IX, new taxes, fees, assessments on the drug industry, the insurance industry, and the pharmaceutical industry. One other little thing that was proposed, by the way, that wasn't in there, people just always like this, there was proposed initially a tax on elective cosmetic surgery, otherwise known popularly as the Botox, or maybe unpopularly known. A big backlash on that from women consumers, particularly, and the American Society of Dermatologists. So that was pulled, and in its place was put a $10 billion tax on indoor tanning services. The indoor tanning industry was caught off guard, and they didn't have time to mobilize to get rid of it. But if you think about it, actually, that probably has more of a positive public health impact than almost anything in the ACA, because I don't know if you've noticed, there is an explosion in melanoma and other forms of skin cancer, particularly among women between the ages of 15 and 35. It is just, and it is very parallel with the increase in the use of these services. So moving on, so looking at some of the spending innovations and where the money comes from in this law, what I did here was rank them based upon the CBO's 10-year savings estimate, so you can see what they're counting on in there, okay? So the big one doesn't take effect until 2018, and that was the highly controversial and contested tax on high premium health insurance policies, otherwise known as the Cadillac excise tax. And some people complain because the tax will clearly fall on Cadillac plans and may fall on a significant amount of Chevy plans as well. So a lot of concern about that moving forward. The estimate of $32 billion in savings, by the way, is not from collecting the tax. The prediction of the Congressional Budget Office is that to prepare for the reality of the tax, employers are going to change their benefit design so that they will not be subject to the excise tax. And as a result of that, they will shift more of their employee compensation from health benefits to wages, which will be subject to all kinds of taxes, and that's where most of the $32 billion is predicted to come from. The Independent Payment Advisory Board is a board of non-public officials that is going to be established and to act if Medicare rates of growth exceed certain set limits beginning in 2015. And I'm going to get back to that in a couple of minutes. Administrative simplification has not been talked about much at all in public. It is one of the most promising areas, and if they are able to do what was being discussed in the process, has the potential to save way more than this $11 billion over 10 years. This is one of the more promising areas. I want to talk about two of these a little bit later, but highlight them right now. Preventable hospital readmissions, and going down a little bit, hospital-acquired infections, is a new class of interventions that hospitals are right now all across the country getting ready for, because hospitals, beginning very soon, are going to start being pinched financially if they have excessively high rates of preventable, emphasis on the word preventable, hospital readmissions and preventable hospital-acquired infections. If their rates are higher than their peers, they're going to start to get stung financially. And I think we can already see some significant changes. And I put those two in particular in a class of interventions that I want to talk more about in a couple of minutes. The pathway for biosimilars, that's Title VII of the law. The fraud and abuse efforts, again, I think we're going to go way, way beyond $7 billion in terms of savings in fraud and abuse. And shared savings, that's the Accountable Care Organizations, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation, physician quality reporting. We get down to the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, otherwise known as PCORI. Job is to create a robust national research agenda on comparative clinical outcomes. That's going to cost money over the first 10 years, and the hope is it's going to save a lot of money moving forward from that. Okay? Here are some of the other innovations that are in the law that, for the most part, got no savings at all or very little savings. If you'd like to see, by the way, the document on which all of this is based, just go to cbo.gov and look for the March 20th, 2010 letter from Nancy Pelosi, from CBO to House Speaker Nancy Pelosi. And that is their final cost estimate on the Affordable Care Act, including the Reconciliation Act. And it is hugely instructive. It is not gospel, as I'm going to tell you about in a minute. But it is the benchmark standard that is used. And here's why it's not gospel. Okay, there's something important to understand about this. And this really matters as you think about quality interventions and what works and dealing with the super committee and dealing with all this stuff in DC. So there was this very smart health services researcher at the University of Chicago. His name is John Gable. And back in 2008, 2009, in conversations with Karen Davis from the Commonwealth Fund, they got a really smart idea. They said, hey, this CBO thing, this Congressional Budget Office, if you're in DC, if you work on Capitol Hill, sometimes it feels like your life, you are slaves to CBO. You do nothing without waiting for CBO. Dick Durbin once said, he said, on my tombstone, he's going to read the words, he was waiting for CBO, okay? I mean, it's just really imposing that people outside of DC don't really appreciate. So Gable and Karen Davis had this idea, said, you know, we've had this CBO now for 35 years. And they have had to score a number of major health policy laws over the years, wonder how they actually did. People get their scores, people get twisted in yoga knots trying to figure out how to deal with them. But then nobody ever goes back and looks and says, so years later, how did they do on those? So they went back and they looked at the three biggest health policy interventions of the past 35 years. They looked at the creation of the 1983 prospective payment system, DRG system, that was created that year by Congress. They looked at the 1997 Balanced Budget Act, and they looked at the 2003 Medicare prescription drug law. And they went back and said, okay, what did they say, and then what really happened? And what they found was that in all three of those cases, not a big enough sample for statistical significance, but telling, in each of those three, CBO was wrong. Not by a little, by a lot, by a country mile. And wrong in each case in the same direction. They overestimated costs and they underestimated savings and revenues. Which, if you think about it, if they're going to be wrong, you'd probably rather they be wrong that way than the other way. Because if they're wrong the other way, you have, you know, your oh shit moment where you think, what do we do now? We've got a financial crisis on our hands. But on the other hand, when they're wrong in the way they're wrong, nobody ever notices or pays attention or goes back. But it gets to the orientation of CBO, which is to be highly conservative in terms of estimating revenues and savings, and highly conservative on the cost side as well, because that's where all their incentives are. And so the point is that if they are wrong on the ACA, then that actually represents good news for all of you, for America as a whole on many, many, many different levels. If in fact the healthcare industry can exceed and do better than what CBO said at a point in time on March 20th, 2010, we should expect. So we've got some really good, and so here gets to two developments that I want to talk to you about that I think are important. The first one, there are a few bloggers talking about it. And almost, I haven't heard anybody else really talk about it very much. Peter Orszag talked about it in a column for Bloomberg a few months ago. Basically, over the past 18 months to 2 years, Medicare's rate of growth is plummeting. So between 2000 and 2009, Medicare's rate of growth on average, year by year, 9.7%, okay? Gulp. That's a lot in a big federal budget, okay? In 2010 and so far in 2011, Medicare's rate of growth is at 4% or less. And by the way, for the 12 months ending May 2011, Medicare's rate of growth for hospitals is around 1%, okay? So that has huge implications if that is a trend. We've seen this happen before. This is not necessarily quite a new story, although the reasons for it, I think, may be new. You know, back, if you look over the big span of the last 30 or 40 years, you know, if you go back to 1980, the United States was one of the most expensive healthcare systems on the planet. And we were bunched with the most expensive systems. So we were high, but we were not an outlier. And it was in the 1980s that we first took off like a rocket and separated from the pack, okay? And then if you go into the 1990s, I don't know how many of you remember the 1990s, but if you go into the 1990s, what we saw was a significant moderation in healthcare spending's rate of growth. We saw in the mid part of the decade, years when, in some parts of the country, healthcare inflation was actually negative for 1 or 2 years. And that lasted most of that decade. And then, in this last decade, the first decade of the new century, we saw expenses soar again. So it is plausible, it is feasible that we may be seeing some moderation going on. We're seeing some indications that it's going down on the private side, though nothing in comparison to Medicare. So what explains what's going on with Medicare? that's really puzzling because on the private side, we know what's going on. Employers are jacking up cost sharing. They're jacking up deductibles and copays that are making more and more regular folks afraid to go to the doctor or the hospital because of how much they're going to pay, even though they have health insurance. But we haven't seen any of those changes at all in the Medicare program. So there's something different happening. What is it? There are a couple. There are several things in particular. I mean, one of them I would suggest that is worth understanding better is fraud and abuse, because it's not just the people who get caught, and there are a lot of people getting caught, particularly in the hot spots of fraud and abuse: Miami, Houston, Los Angeles, Detroit, sorry, New York. There's a lot, but here's this, somebody said, you know, the single best day for the IRS, for the Internal Revenue Service, was the day they sent Martha Stewart to jail. Because you know what it said? It said to every American, it said, man, if they're going to throw Martha Stewart in jail, I better be careful, because I could be next. And so it's the effect of all of the publicity on fraud and abuse that may have. We know there's a lot of fraud and abuse. We don't know how much. It's possible we're seeing that. But even more importantly than that is something that I'd be interested if it resonates with all of you, okay? But I believe, and I'm seeing, and I observe it, and I've seen other people say it, there is a wave of innovation going on right now in the U.S. healthcare delivery system. And it is particularly aimed at improving quality, creating value, and lowering costs. I had breakfast yesterday with a friend of mine from who's the CFO from a big teaching hospital in Boston. And he said, you know, he said 2 years ago, we were thinking about how we were going to have to increase by 50 to 100%, double the size of our ICU, because we just didn't have enough beds. And today, we have a lot of excess capacity. And I said, what's going on? He said two things in particular. We are getting really serious about hospital-acquired infections. And as a result of that, we are benchmarking, we're publicly posting our measures, and a result of that, so much of that business going into our ICU was self-generated within the hospital. And it's not going there anymore. And he thinks it's good news, although it's not a wonderful story in terms of the finances of the hospital, but basically it's hard to argue with. And the other piece is this, is preventable readmissions. And actually, just when you've got a 75-year-old who just had heart surgery, and you have that discharge meeting where you give him a stack of paper and you say, remember this, remember this, remember 20 things, and he says, yeah, 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 and he goes home and he doesn't remember any of them, okay? They are now feeling responsible for what happens to that guy when he goes, and to make sure that there's follow-up and attention paid so that they don't have a repeat of that. Okay? So there's something happening, and if we look at what's happening across the healthcare system, we're seeing that. As Lucian Leap at Harvard says, the cat is out of the bag on hospital-acquired infections. There are hospitals around this country that are getting the rates of certain infections down to zero. Zero, Z-E-R-O, big goose egg, okay? So that has an impact. So there is, in fact, I would think, a new category, a new class of interventions, okay? And it's not about accountable care organizations. It's not about accountable care organizations, because most parts of the U.S. healthcare system are not going to become an accountable care organization. What it is about and what it should be about is accountable care, okay? Leave all this, you know, this corporate restructuring stuff. You know, we go through that all the time. It's about fixing care, whether you're a big integrated healthcare system or whether you're a tiny little hospital or tiny little practice, okay? And so it gets down to taking off admissions and infections, creating a larger family of events. And the larger family of events we can categorize as potentially preventable events. And there are five of them. There's five categories or classes of potentially preventable events. There's potentially preventable readmissions. There are potentially preventable admissions. There are potentially preventable complications. during an inpatient stay. There are potentially preventable emergency department visits, and there are potentially preventable outpatient procedures that don't need to happen. The New York Times had the story a few months ago of the large number of Medicare enrollees around the country getting two chest CT scans in the same day, the same visit. No clinical indication at all, zero, happening all over the country, okay? So the way I think things are moving, the way I think the system is heading, is toward a much heavier, serious focus on, for lack of a better term, stop paying for stupid stuff. Stop paying for unnecessary things that raise costs and harm people. And it seems to me that the smart organizations, the organizations that are going to do the best, and the organizations that are going to lead and thrive in this new era that we're moving into, are the organizations that can embrace that ethos. And there are other folks, if you're interested in this, who can come to you and talk about this in much more detail with much more precision. But if you're looking for where things are going, I think that's where it's going. I think where it's going, we're getting beyond pay for performance, getting beyond sort of rewarding people just based upon process measures, and we're reaching the point now where we can actually start to pay for outcomes. And that's where I think the system is going, and I think it's where the system has to go. These are just some resources. If you want to keep up with the law, keep up with the implementation drama. If you want to see the ACA, you know, you can get it online. Just Google Affordable Care Act text. It'll come up for you. A lot of great resources. You can see the CBO report online, Commonwealth Fund, Kaiser, Health Reform, GPS. If you just can't get enough of it. How many of you, by the way, get Politico Pulse every day? Right, okay. It's a daily email of news, information, analysis, and gossip about health reform. Just go to Politico, you can sign. So there's so much there to do it. But we have just an enormous challenge. I think there's an enormously positive story that we have to communicate with the American people about what's happened already with the Affordable Care Act, help people understand what's in there. But we got a big challenge ahead of us. We've got less than 14 months now until November 6, 2012. And that is, in many ways, potentially D-Day for health reform, whether we're going to continue moving forward or whether we're going to take some enormous, huge steps backwards. And it's right on the edge right now. It can go either way. So please continue all the great work you're doing, and please be a part of helping America to understand what we've accomplished, what we've achieved, where we have to go, and what the stakes are. Thanks very much. Yeah.